even answer him, and he took me with him. I mean, he had more courage than I know what, because I could have given a bad time. Anyway, so once we had the weapons from the gendarme and from the city hall and their ammunition, and he had a problem mismatching the ammunition and the weapons, because there were all kinds of caliber there, somebody got in touch with a group of the resistance in the valley. They went into a factory that was making uniforms for the Vichy Groupe de Jeunesse. They had khaki jackets, green pants. They stole them all out and brought them up to us in the mountains. Then somehow they had a parachutage. An American captain from the Office of Strategic Services, Captain Bank, was parachuted in that area to get information. And group the people and train us. We were the first group trained by him, about 20 of us, because he was parachuted. He came from Algeria, parachuted in southern France, after having just graduated from the OSS school in England. So he trained us in use of weapons, Russian, German, Italian weapons, and plastic explosives.
So in other words, you now have joined the underground, the resistance, is that correct?
Well, there's resistance and underground, well, Maquis. The Maquis, more or less, were the organized, uniformed troops, although communist groups did not wear uniforms, generally. And the resistance were the people in the towns, usually, that gave you information about hiding and such, for, you know, disappearing and providing food and whatnot.
We left off on the last tape. I asked you if you then joined the resistance, and you were making a distinction between various factions of this movement.
Well, basically, what you had there, you had the resistance, which were civilians in the towns. They were making false identification papers. They were sending people, youngsters, into the mountains. They had chains organized where you could move from safe house to safe house. They were usually sending information to England on the German troops, concentrations, military information, and so on and so forth. The Maquis were the young people who were required to go to Germany, or Jewish people who were hiding, and were then the fighting units when they got weapons. In the beginning, they had no weapons. The underground, per se, I would qualify this as a combination of both resistance and Maquis, because they worked as one unit. They were all in hiding or illegal, under illegal names or whatnot.
So how did you make contact? When you decided to become part of this, how did you make contact with the
group? Well, in the village, you know, we did not have any direct contact with them, but they decided to have a group get together with weapons and asked us to join at that time.
And did your father join too, or just you and
oh
your
no,
brother?
Just me and my brother.
And then you mentioned there was an American that was shot down?
No, he was parachuted.
He was parachuted down?
Yes.
And his name was?
Aaron Bank.
And what was his job?
He was a captain in the Office of Strategic Services, OSS, and his job was to, first of all, reconnoiter the area, find out where the German troops were, to see the strength of the resistance, if they can be trusted with weapons. And the reason for that was that the communist organizations that were also in the underground usually did not put their weapons to use. They were thinking of liberation and then taking over the French government. So this was strictly the idea of the OSS to not to distribute any weapons to them. only to the Adal Makizar.
So were you trained by this captain?
Yes.
What were you trained in?
In the explosives, plastic explosives, sabotage, how to blow up trees and whatnot. We were told not to make any permanent destructions such as bridges, because soon they would have to be used by the Allies.
Was there a name given to your group, or?
We were the, Saint-Germain-de-Calbert had its own commando, which was called Corps Franc, C-O-R-P-S, Franc, F-R-A-N-C. That's actually, you might call it a commando, basically.
And how long was your training?
A few days only. Because the captain had quite a job on his hands to go other places too. And he trained us in weapons, pistols, guns and whatnot. But we did not have actually that type of equipment. What happened is that when the Allied started to drop weapons to us, they dropped captured weapons that had captured from the German army or Italian army. And those were either Russian rifles that the German army used, Italian rifles, German rifles. They had some French machine guns and also British automatic rifles. So it was a collaboration that we had to be very careful not to mix the ammunition because it didn't fit. You could jam your rifle by doing that. And those were actually dropped to us later on, not right away, because still the area was still under German control and they did not want us to start too soon when we were not prepared.
So what did you do next? After you were trained, where did you go?
Okay, then we had groups being trained in other areas in the region, and then we grouped all of us together into one camp in Sainte-Croix, Vallée Française. Well, it's just another village. We had about 60 to 80 people at the time.
And who was your leader?
There was a French reserve officer.
What was his name?
I've forgotten. I wish to forget it too, because he was he was really so stupid. I mean, he was a reserve officer that, when we got the weapons, they had me go on top of a hill at night, and they set up a mortar. And they told me, take this flashlight and show us about where the shells are falling. Well, I was on the other side of the hill, and they start firing, and I am on the other side, and the shells are falling right where I am. So I tried to rush right away on top of the hill, show them the flashlight, and then I let them have it. They kept the firing for a little while longer, but then it stopped. I was so mad. I mean, I didn't care if it was a lieutenant or whatever it was, you know. Anyway, he was replaced soon thereafter by a captain, a reserve captain, who was a very nice man. He was a teacher, and he came up there. And when we got our weapons, then we went down into the valley. On August 16, 1944, the Americans landed in southern France. And that was the order we received in the morning. We woke up and we heard artillery fire way in the distance by the coast. So there was a sign we had to go regroup and go south towards the city of Alès. Well, Alès was still heavily occupied. They had about 2,000 German troops there. We stopped about 10 miles outside of the city in a small village called Générargues. On Sunday, this was middle of the week, on Sunday, we had people from the village, from Alès, came to us and said, hey, there's a spy in the group coming over here. There was a bath, a river or something they were coming to bathe at. So they told us who it was, and I went over there and arrested that one gal. She was about 17 years old, and I took her to the commander. He interrogated her, searched her, they found a pistol on her. She was a girlfriend of a collaborator, of what they called the milice, and she came to spy on us and report back there. but she was released after we took the pistol away. And her boyfriend was still in Alès. When we got into the city a few days later, he was arrested and shot by a different group. On the 21st of August, they said that the population in Alès was an uprising, that the Germans were shooting them in the streets. They had about killed 8 or 9 civilians. So we're told, have to go in there now. And there we were on a truck. We had about 35 to 40 people with us altogether. We got in there. The Germans had apparently fled. The population had put out the French flag all over the place. And my commander put me in charge at the crossroad to cover traffic over there, make sure there's no enemy coming by. Then civilians came to me and said, Germans are coming back. They are out in Saint-Christol-les-Alais, about 10 kilometers, about 7-8 miles away. Well, here are the French flags all over the place. I am away from my commander. He is in reconnaissance somewhere else. What am I going to do? There was a truck passing, and I stopped him. I said, my man, we go in there. 10 men. I had 5 civilians that decided to join me. I had hand grenades for them. The Germans had abandoned a school in which they had bivouacked, and they left hand grenades behind them. So I took them with 5 civilians, by 10 men. And I was not in charge. I was just the only one that took over. So we went in a truck to the village. There was actually a platoon of gendarmes, and there was a French machine gun, a heavy machine gun, with 2 guys there. They had been dropped off by their commander, and he had left. So I asked the gendarme, will you come with us? No, we stay here. Well, one of my men had put the wrong bullet in his pistol, in his rifle, and jammed it. There was a mechanic in the village that I asked him to remove the bullet. He did that, and then he has the audacity to ask me for money. I said, we came over here to liberate you, and you have the gall to ask me for money? We give you a bullet. He changed his tune in a hurry. Then I sent 5 men one way. I left 5 men with the machine gun there, with the other 2 guys, and I took 5 men on the other side. The Germans were behind the village in a small farm having lunch. And there were 20 trucks, I counted them, because when we they went on the road afterwards. My group on the left side started firing at them. So the Germans tried to attack them. The road went from the village, from the farm to that highway only, and I was on the other side. There was no road there for them. So when they get on the road, they get fired on from the other side too, from the south, from the north, I should say. They tried to run the other way, and I am with my 5 men on the third attack. We hit them from 3 sides. They didn't know what happened. One truck was put in put on fire. They abandoned one with all kinds of furniture that had stolen someplace, and they left. I mean, 15 men against 150 to 200 Germans. I mean, you have to be crazy.
What weapons did you use?
I had a Mauser, a German rifle. And there was one BAR automatic rifle that the group on the left had used, and a machine gun in the village.
So you surrounded them and captured them?
No, we didn't capture them. They escaped. But then we protected the city by doing that. Then truck came back with a white flag. And I said to my men, down. I don't trust them. Sure enough, they come over. And then we had received reinforcement. A group of communist Maquis came over, and 3 of them moved on to the German with the flag, and they captured them. We found them dead later on. They were machine gunned. And one of my friends, my man had gotten up to, and the German shot him in the leg, and they shot through the artery with dum-dum bullets. They explode, they make a big hole. We put them on a ladder. We got from a farm and carried them in the vineyard. The vines were about that high. We crawled on the ground, making sure we did not raise any dust, because Germans would have picked us off too. We went back into the village, And Captain Bank was over there already. He had arrived there with my commander, which was Commandant, I forget his name now. Anyway, I explained to them what happened. And then they said, okay, take the wounded man to Alès. So we went back over there. They had reinforcements and they held the positions from that point on. The three prisoners that they had captured, the Germans, were found about 10 miles further down the line at the road, killed. The Germans, I believe, had cut their ears off, punched out their eyes, massacred them. I mean, they called us terrorists and they had no use for us. Sometimes it paid to be in uniform like we were. We were identified with armband and uniform, because if the Germans could tell the difference between us and the civilians, they would not spare us, but may leave the civilians alone. But like the communist groups were not in uniform, the Germans couldn't tell the difference. And when they found they had been shot at, they could take any civilian and shoot them as hostages too. Anyway, my commander says, anybody that's stupid enough to do what you did should go to officer school. God. I became an officer shortly thereafter, but the school took a few more months before I got to it. I got my commission first. And then, with some more skirmishes, the next day, I was put on a different crossroad with a group. We had an automatic rifle there on position, and my commander gave me authorization to go into the town, Alès, for the afternoon. I get to Alès and I hear that Germans are coming on the other side too. Well, my brother was still in that other place too, which is called, I have maps on it too, I can tell you. Anyway, I have just a potato masher, a German hand grenade in my belt, and I have a bicycle that somebody had lent me, and I go back to the village. As I get close to the village, the people are staying there, hey, the Germans are out there, and they give me a small pistol. I don't know, I call it 25 millimeter or so. No, not 25 millimeter, 2.5 millimeter or something like that, probably. No, it was a little bigger. We call that pistolet de femme jalouse. It's a jealous wife pistol, because I have it in the pocket, I shoot something. Anyway, I have my hand grenade pistol, and I get there. The Germans had been shot at by a machine gun. The three people in front had been killed. And I get there as I find a pistol in the side of the road. I grab the pistol, put my rifle on my shoulder, and as I get to the truck, Germans are jumping out of it, two of them. I'm right behind them. I tell them to hand the whore, up your arms, to surrender. Later on, I found out that had they turned around, I would have been dead. The reason is this. The pistol that I had was a P-38, a German pistol. When you have a bullet in it, it raises a small lever that says geladen, loaded. Not only was this lever down, they could have seen it was empty, but I had not even a charger in the pistol. But it happened so fast, a crazy guy. Anyway, we had a few more skirmishes then. There were 13 Germans in that truck. Altogether, the three that were killed in front, one that was on the side of the wheel and had a machine gun and he had got shot in the lungs. The two that jumped out and the rest disappeared in the hills. We found them before the evening. Anyway, the two that I had captured, I interrogated them. I first separated them and interrogated them separately, because if one wants to talk, the other one should not know that he's talking and what he's saying. But they wouldn't say a word anyway. But I told him, if we knew them, they got scared, you know, because they knew what I had done to Jews. But I am the type of guy that if I don't have a weapon on a prisoner, I don't touch a prisoner.
You didn't have a weapon at this point?
No, I mean, if they have no weapons, if they're disarmed, I wouldn't touch a prisoner. I just consider them as a prisoner. And I told him, we'll treat you according to the Geneva Convention. I didn't know much about the Geneva Convention, but I knew that that was the way to treat them. Anyway, we fed them, gave them water, we gave cigarettes. The one that was wounded, we took him and gave him bandages. We bandaged him up as much as we could. Actually, we had no bandages, but we took them off the other prisoners. They had gray packages of bandages. Then I was sent back with the prisoners to Alès, to the school, where they had put the people that had been shot by the Germans on display. They had put them on for a religious ceremony there. And when the Germans brought in, we were lucky that the population didn't kill them. I mean, they were so mad at them, you know. Anyway, we protected them. Then brought him to the headquarters. The wounded guy was left in the school, which was serving as a first aid place. Then I took the other two prisoners with me to the headquarters in the city hall. I turned them over to the there was a captain over there from a different outfit. And since I spoke German first, I interrogated them, and then they took over. They put me in jail, I guess. But he was lucky. They were lucky.
You didn't get any information from them at all?
No. But hey, there's no point. But the only thing I found from them is that they were firemen from the airport in Nîmes, which was not too far from there. They could have told me anything, but I figured I'd let somebody else do it. Then during the week, there were some more combats. Then this was still a very small group, between 20 and 40 people, depending on where we were located. On Sunday, the 27th of August, we were told that the Germans are coming, and they have been pillaging in the villages in the area. They have been massacring people and whatnot, and we are going to attack them. We got reinforcement. About 80 people or 90 people or so joined us. They had received their weapons just the day before. They had no training. Their weapons and that's it. But they were courageous. They went with us. We went on top of hills, covering the road. We were on three hills. We had two machine guns set up and one automatic rifle. About 2 o'clock in the afternoon, we hear my commander had gone ahead with his car and had it reconnaissance and turned around quickly when he saw the Germans coming. So they are coming on horseback, on bicycles, all kinds of transportation. They had been shot at before, so one of our guys opened up the fire too soon. They were still at quite a distance. So he shot, two guys on motorcycle, but there was too far away, so he killed them probably, but the troop was alerted, which was the bad part. As soon as they hear the firing, the Germans disappeared in the vicinity. I mean, they were professional soldiers. We were not. We sent a man back to the town of Alès to notify Captain Bank that we are attacking the German column. So he calls up the Air Force. And there were two or three planes that arrived half an hour later and machine gunned the Germans on the road there. That was a pleasure. I mean, we were there and, we made a big mistake, though. We all got up and clapping and waving flags at the planes. They spotted us, the Germans, you know. As soon as the planes turned around, they hit us with a mortar, artillery, all kinds of stuff. This was within about 6 or 7 hours, and they hit us badly. My brother was killed. I was shell-shocked, I was thrown on the ground, lost my hearing. 6 or 7 guys were wounded also. But we had good positions, so in general, we were very lucky that we survived.
Was this? Where are you now? Where are you in France?
East of Alès. I can't show you the map.
Alès is where? Southern France.
It's about maybe 100 miles from the coast, kilometers I should say, so maybe 80, 90 miles from the coast. And the German divisions were retreating from Toulouse, they were coming along. Their first orders were first to go to stop the Americans who had landed in southern France. But because the attack was, the Allied attack was successful, they had already driven the Germans up the Rhone Valley. These were no longer trying to reach them and help them, but to escape themselves and going up the valley. So they were in different groups. But we made more than one mistake. The first mistake was to shoot too soon. The second one was, and to wave the Germans. And the other one was that, I don't remember now.
You said you made two mistakes.
We made that one too. We talked too soon and we showed up too soon. Yeah, but that was it basically. And no, the other one was that we were not supposed to stay there. We were supposed to attack, let them go by, and this was another group attack them again. We were hit and run groups. We were not supposed to fight them to a standstill because we had no training and insufficient forces. That was our mistake there. The captain says we have to stop them over here. Later on, he realized that. In the subsequent information that I received there, they said, "Yeah, we goofed. We should never have stopped them for 6-7 hours. Hit them, surprise them, and then on to a different area, attack them again." It's very demoralizing if you are being attacked every few miles. Finally, another group attacked them 2 days later and captured them, most of them. I have the picture of the commander too, because he was captured also. So my brother was killed, but there were not 3,000 Germans. There were 1,000 Germans and 2,000 Russians. The Russians had surrendered or had volunteered. Some were from the Vlasov army that had surrendered in Russia, and the Russians didn't trust them over there, so they sent them to France where they couldn't speak to the people. They couldn't speak French. And they were far away from their own country. So they did not fight wholeheartedly. When they could surrender, they surrendered. We captured about 300 of them that had hidden during the night. One of our guys captured by himself about 27. What happened? He was stuck also during the night. In the morning, he sees those people hiding. So he comes over there and he makes them understand that they're surrounded, that they will be shot if they don't surrender. You know? So they did. They just wanted an opportunity to surrender. And we captured about 300 altogether. That was really some fight. So the next day we had my brother, we took him back to the village in a truck, his body, and 2 days later we buried him. The Protestant minister made the eulogy, and I have a copy of it also in French. And it was the whole village was there because the first friend of mine that was shot in the leg had died the week before. So when Max was killed, the second one from the village, then about 600 or 700 people showed up. There was almost the whole village.
Were your parents there too?
Yeah. The terrible thing was when my father was killed, they notified the post office. And they notified my father. And when I came in there, we took the casket off the truck, and my father says, "This is my son." Oh God, you know, I mean, he broke down. And they wanted to see my brother, but they didn't open the casket. It was very disfigured. That's why in one of the books they say that I had been killed. They thought it was me. They couldn't recognize him. So after that,